You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, Bill Deluca here from THE100. I'm enjoying reading this chapter that we're going to talk about today on tragedy, comedy, and tragicomedy. So I'm delighted that you've joined us. We have an interesting program. We're going to talk not only about the dramatic forms of theater, but we are going to talk a little bit about film today, look at some of the history of film, and then we have a wonderful film, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, that we're going to spend a lot of time with. This is the first of the five films that we will go into depth with in the class here. So yes, a little bit of the history of film, Crouching Tiger, and we're going to talk about tragedy and comedy. So in order to try to get you to interact with us, there you see our toll-free number, 1-800-339-1193. We'd love to hear a comment or a question that you might have about any of our topics today. Or you may want to join our students who are going to go online and type in a response or a question to askdhtv@gmail.com. So look forward to hearing from you. If you type a response in there, I can read it on the screen here in the studio so that we create something of a dialogue. Now, as I said, these classes, this is our third broadcast, so I try to let people know what's happening. It seems like students are well on their way to handling the quizzes very well and the discussion boards. We have opened the class up until the 21st, so everything is open until the 21st. That gives us gives you a little bit more time, a couple more days to get these assignments done. And we have some interesting discussion board postings already. Just this last week, when we were talking about the audience, which was our first topic, Drew Berra wrote, "There are very subtle differences between the performers of the great theaters of the world and the stars of today's modern film that many people, myself included, until recently didn't realize. To be quite honest, this class is the first time that I've had the real experience with theater, but I've already begun to form opinions on the differences between actors of the two great medias. I mean, consider how much more the actors of theater have to prepare for each and every role. They have to know the entire show." Drew goes on at length because he knows we're asking for at least 100 words here, but we want to go into some depth in your observation. Now, Farin Balak responded to Drew with this: "That is very well put. I've never really considered how much more difficult it is for a performer to act up on the stage than in front of a camera. Even if you take out the factor of the live audience, it is easy to see how much more difficult it is for them when you consider that the actors in theater have to know the entire play inside and out." And Farin goes on as well. So we are getting exactly what a discussion board is designed for, a response, but also a reply. So very good on getting us going there. And this week we're talking about tragedy, comedy, and tragicomedy, so the responses will be different. So it seems like students are understanding what we're doing here. By the way, next week I have a guest who's going to come on to the program. We're going to talk about directing next broadcast. And I have Dr. Sherelle Luckett, who is our new faculty member, who's directing Top Dog Underdog, which opens next Thursday. So it'll be great to have her here to talk a little bit about what's happened with the rehearsals for the show. And if anyone is interested who's in the area and wants to come to our show, it basically opens on Thursday, February 27th, 28th, March 1st and 7th at 8 o'clock. And then we have two matinees, March 2nd and 9th at 2 p.m. Ah, there's the details on it. So yeah, this is a wonderfully intense drama about two black brothers kind of confronting each other. It won the Pulitzer Prize in 2002 for Susan Laurie Parks, the playwright. So hopefully you can join us, and this could be one of the plays that you write about for your stage review. So Top Dog Underdog opens here at Dominguez Hills next week. One other thing I think I should warn you about is that the following week, after directing, comes Raisin in the Sun. So if you can, get a copy of the actual script rather than reading things online, and be prepared to do your character analysis. So you may want to look ahead at what's required there, but it's a long play. So even if you've seen movie versions, I want you to kind of look into this play and see how a playwright actually constructs a scene. So Raisin in the Sun, that's coming up as well. Okay, I thought what we'd do, I normally begin every class with a little bit of the history of theater, and we started with Africa already, but since we're going to look at Crouching Tiger and Hidden Dragon today, I thought we'd talk a little bit about the history of film, just to kind of set it up for you, because film really began as a novelty item. It's just kind of a thing to just kind of glare at, as different from what it's become today, which is a a major tool for entertainment, for communication, for the mass media. But it began in a kind of humorous way. Obviously, there's a long history of plays that have helped prepare for it. And even in the 1600s, there was the camera obscura, which allowed you to see a moving image, though upside down, just by having a little hole in a screen. But it wasn't until Edward Muybridge in 1878 began to use 24 cameras to capture the motion of a horse running that we started trying to record motion. And we start moving towards motion pictures. William Dixon, who was working at the Edison Labs, is the first to create the first celluloid strip. Oh, there he is, right there. It's great that our studio has some images to back this up. But now a person could go to, let's say, a kinetoscope, which actually the Edison Labs developed for the Chicago World Fair, and a single person could view that loop on an electric motor so that they could see something very simple, someone sneezing, or maybe an acrobat or a boxer. There's Mr. Edison himself. It had begun, but it really took Robert Paul and Bert Akers in 1895, there's Paul, to invent a projector. In other words, something that could project this moving image onto a wall so that, and there's Bert Akers, so that a group of people could see it. Now we are on our way to motion pictures. So that was pivotal. And of course, since the link between sound and film would not happen until 1927, the science just was not there technically, we get the silent film era. And we don't watch silent films much anymore. Audio has pretty much overrode that very strange, as I was saying, it's a bit of a novelty to watch a silent film anymore. But oddly enough, if you were watching a Vitascope or a Mutascope or a Nickelodeon, which was the way that you could see in a projecting system, there's a great example of a Nickelodeon, you would be seeing perhaps someone playing the piano while the actors on the screen were miming, talking, but you wouldn't hear them. Oddly enough, though the silent films seem antiquated, all of the basics of film technique were created in those years before 1927, when we get the jazz singer, the first talkie, as we say. So things like panoramas, they had put the camera on the back of a train and tried to take a landscape shot, and that actually became known as a pan shot, short for panorama. Oh, great, there's a great poster for Al Jolson's The Jazz Singer. So we get motions of the camera, we get stage effects. There was a famous execution of Mary, Queen of Scots, with a stop action just when they were about to chop her head off. slow motion, fast motion, reverse motion, all of this had been developed by 1901, 1902. Single frame animation had already been created, and a lot of the basic film continuity ideas. We'll talk about this when we get into editing more extensively. But for instance, the idea that you'd have a shot of a character looking at something in the distance, and then you'd get the POV shot of what that character is looking at, some landscape or whatever. So it kind of puts you into the film. You're seeing what the character is seeing. All these techniques, right at the beginning of this whole era. And the great train robbery, as early as 1903, starts to use many of these techniques of cross-cutting between parallel actions. Birth of a Nation, 1915, D.W. Griffith's great epic, was notorious for using a lot of these techniques, but notorious is perhaps the better word for the riots that happened, because it was something of a racist film that featured the Ku Klux Klan, and that was early on, 1915. By 1912, they were putting the actors' names into the films, and that created another development that we all share today, the star system. So if Charlie Chaplin was in the show, all you had to do, there he is, there's Chaplin, all you had to do on the marquee outside was Charlie Chaplin in whatever name the film was, and people would go and see it because they love Charlie Chaplin or Buster Keaton. There's great close-up of Chaplin, I love that. Buster Keaton, Douglas Fairbanks, Clara Bow, all of a sudden we have these great names that are driving people to see shows, Buster Keaton right there. So the star system, the idea of selling a show by the name of the actors who are in the show, becomes very, very true to Hollywood. I think that's Clara Bow, very, very good image of her. And of course, the move to Southern California was strategic, not only to get away from the Edison patents that had kind of taken control in New Jersey, but also to do things like film westerns, which became very, very important out here. So I'm just trying to show how all of these techniques and the technology that goes along with them, floodlights, so that you didn't have to just film in the daytime, you could actually film at night, and you would have floodlights that would create the effect of sunlight. Techniques of like the iris coming in when you wanted to close a scene, or the iris coming out so you wanted to introduce a scene. This had all been established. Fade-outs and fade-ins, which basically derive from theater, were used quite extensively. Insert shots so that D.W. Griffith could put in like a huge landscape to insert in there to kind of set the scene. So a lot of these basic techniques, flashbacks were used extensively. You could use a kind of fade out of one scene as the character is thinking, and then the next scene leads into what they're thinking about, remembering something that happened before. So flashbacks were even established in the silent film era. Of course, everyone was waiting finally for the movies to talk, even though by the 1920s, America was turning out 800 silent films a year. So the industry was established. But when Al Jolson does The Jazz Singer in 1927, now we get a major jump in terms of what's going to happen. It ushered in what will become the golden age, because not only do we get Al Jolson singing, but we're going to get Gable, Hepburn, Bogart, Garbo, all these great draws. There's Clark Gable. Shirley Temple will become a darling in films in the 1930s. There she is, look at her. We just lost her, that's sad. So all of these great stars are going to make the movies of the 30s and 40s so, so popular. And dialogue, now that we can hear people talk, all of a sudden is going to make films witty. So we get plays now that are like the Marx Brothers, Duck Soup, It Happened One Night, The Front Page, films that are very talky. And people just love hearing that effect. Obviously, musicals were born in the 30s. We start getting these Busby Berkeley extravaganzas that feature hundreds of dancers on stage. And in fact, Bollywood in India gets its origins from the talkies as well. So all around the world, it's a boom to the industry. And of course, we get horror films. So you have Boris Karloff as Frankenstein, 1931, and Dracula's in there, King Kong. We get westerns. There is King Kong. I mean, really, that establishes the horror movies in a very strong way, and all the different remakes that we've had. We have gangster films, 1930s, that became very popular, especially after the 20s and the age of Prohibition. So we get Little Caesar, poster for Edward G. Robinson and Little Caesar, Public Enemy number one, 1931. So this established, yes, Public Enemy was another one that established, helped establish this fascination we have with the dark under crime worlds below. So genres begin to develop. Disney brings us Snow White, 1937, the first of our animated children's shows, and that's going to live on for quite a while. By the time we get to 1939, it's almost like we've had a crescendo of sorts in the film industry when you're looking at Gone with the Wind and Wizard of Oz in the same year. I mean, the wonderful, famous poster of, and there's Wizard of Oz. So in a very short amount of time, film had gone from just a novelty to a major, major entertainment, such that 90 million people in the middle of the Depression are going to the movies every week. It's astounding how popular it had come to be. And World War II comes in and forces films to become perhaps a little more patriotic. Yankee Doodle Dandy, Casablanca, these are films that refer to our effort. There's James Cagney playing one of the great heroes, Michael Cohen, George M. Cohen, who was a famous American musical star at the beginning of this century. And then there's Casablanca with Bogart and Bergman. The war interests helped to make things change. By the time we get to the 1950s and we have the Cold War and some darker times, we actually get, because of this nuclear proliferation that's happening between Russia and America, a kind of strange offshoot where now we have B-grade horror movies that feature some kind of mutation that is released in America, or we have huge ants attacking Los Angeles. When Orson Welles did War of the Worlds, it showed a kind of fascination with our world being attacked. So all of a sudden, these B-grade horror movies reflect a little bit of what's happening in the 1950s. And television causes movies to react because they can't match what television is doing, but films can be bigger than life. So we all of a sudden we get CinemaScope and movies like The Robe and Oklahoma, Around the World in 80 Days, South Pacific, huge epic kinds of shows like Oklahoma, great example. So things that you could not see on a small TV, you could go to the movies and still see. And of course, Disney really took off in the 50s with Ladies as a Tramp, Sleeping Beauty. Peter Pan was very popular. Old Yeller, even 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. So all of a sudden, all the animated films take off, and that would continue into the 60s as well. So we get Mary Poppins and The Sound of Music and My Fair Lady. However, the 60s is going to bring in new realities as well, and film will respond so that now people are going to see movies like The Graduate or The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, Rosemary's Baby. There's The Graduate, pivotal show about what direction we're going to go in. Wonderful Mike Nichols film. But these were films that weren't just entertaining. They were provocative for some of the issues that America was going through at the time. Midnight Cowboy, Easy Rider. These were films that showed a new culture that was rising in the late 60s. So things were changing. Oh, there's that great poster from Easy Rider. And the music, obviously, that was being used in many of these films was very contemporary, so pop and rock started playing major parts. And by the time we get to the 1970s, we start getting these great, great directors. Now, all of a sudden, we have Scorsese and Francis Ford Coppola, Steven Spielberg, George Lucas, Brian De Palma. And film goes into a much new era where we are kind of moving towards much more creative pursuits, much more individualistic ideals. Even Bruce Lee is introducing martial arts films, or Jackie Chan later would bring such wonderful comedy to it. There's Jackie Chan, great image of him. And as we'll see today, Ang Lee brings a rather sophisticated poetry to what we'll see in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. And of course, by the 1980s, when VCRs come in, it changes everything now that you can watch a movie on your home television screen. And the independence movement in the 90s bring out all of these very unique new films, Pulp Fiction 1994, or Beauty and the Beast, Lion King. We're getting some new provocative insights with the use of film that have given us what we're looking at today. So from what began as a novelty to now what is a major contribution to reflections of our own culture, film has become perhaps our most favorite medium. It's something that we now can watch at home. We can stream it in from our computers now. And it has become very, very central to who we are. Before we get to Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, which is a wonderful martial arts film, but certainly one that has gone beyond just being a martial arts film, I want to look a little bit to talk with you about modern tragedy, traditional tragedy, and modern tragedy. And in fact, if you have any desire to respond to a focus question, this might be something you can think about as we're talking about this, but describe in your own words one of the characteristics of traditional tragedy. What do you have to have involved in creating a traditional tragedy? Obviously, I'm talking about what the ancient Greeks were writing about or what Shakespeare was writing about. So what would be one characteristic of traditional tragedy? That'll be our focus question for this session here. And it's a very helpful exercise to go through and look at the different genres that we have in theater. And tragedy and comedy are obviously the two most important. There are many others, as the book goes into, for instance, heroic drama. But tragedy and comedy are very much the central ideas. I love this wonderful image here from, I think this is in Hartford Stage. Where was this done? Oh, it's at the McCarter, which is in New Jersey. Fabulous theater, but wonderful costuming there for this very unique image of She Stoops to Conquer. We're doing a very similar show, School for Scandal, which looks like this in terms of costuming. So hopefully when I get the poster, I'll share that with you too. You may want to come and see School for Scandal on our campus. So tragedy and comedy. What is a tragedy? I've had some interesting observations already online, but one of the unique definitions is Aristotle's. And he defines it that tragedy involves a serious action of universal significance. Interesting that Aristotle, he's speaking in the 4th century BC about plays that he was watching 100 years after they were actually created. So he's looking at things like Oedipus Rex, and he's making these comments about them. There he is right there. Thank you, Mr. Aristotle. But tragedy involves a serious action that has universal significance. So it has important moral, philosophical implications as well. And following Aristotle, most critics would agree that a tragic hero or heroine is someone who's essentially an admirable person, but whose downfall elicits our sympathy in some way. In other words, we have to feel bad for them because they may have something that is a tragic flaw, as it's called. Even if Hamlet dies at the end, we should feel uplifted that somehow his efforts have allowed heroism to still survive, even though he, the person, does not. So it's tragedies are meant to be uplifting, even though the word sounds like it's just going to be a depressing play, but it's exactly the opposite. It's food for thought and for the heart as to how we as a culture survive. So, you know, and the disastrous outcome of a tragedy should be seen as the inevitable result of the character and his or her situation. In other words, we bring this on ourselves by something that we've done or forgotten to do. So this is a lot of what Aristotle has said. And it's interesting that he talks about it being serious, complete, and of a certain magnitude, that it has to have some kind of stature for it to truly be a tragedy. It's not just a man's driving his car and drives into a tree and dies. That is a tragedy, and it is a human loss, but it's not the same as tragedy as we mean it in terms of a play. Concerning the fall of a man whose character is good, whose misfortune is brought about not by vice or depravity, but by some error or frailty. So, for instance, in Oedipus Rex, it's Oedipus's anger that is his tragic flaw. Interesting that so many still suffer from that problem. That's an issue for so many. So perhaps Sophocles was speaking for many centuries of human beings, not just the 5th century BC in Athens, when he was writing about Oedipus being so consumed by his own anger. So that's an observation that Aristotle had about that focus. Whereas you look at Macbeth, for instance, and you see how ambition is going to be his undoing. And this is very true of major tragic heroes. With events arousing pity and fear, wherewith to accomplish the catharsis of these emotions. Now, this is a very interesting idea that Aristotle mentions, that somehow the events have to arouse in us pity, sympathy, empathy, and fear, that somehow it has to frighten us in a way that we can perhaps identify with it, such that it creates a sense of tension, a sense of tightness, and that the effect of watching a tragedy should be one of catharsis. In other words, we somehow are relieved of that tension by the end of the play, and we can feel a sense of a new kind of relaxation or a new kind of order as a result of kind of expurging that tension that was created. Interesting observation for someone from the 5th century BC, because this is very current information about what happens when we actually watch a serious play. So very unique. And he also mentions that there should be heightened language as well that goes along with this. As well as this kind of release of the tension into a kind of purification. So there should be heightened language. And as you know, the Greek tragedies and Shakespeare, Elizabethans, were all verse dramas, sometimes rhymed. So very much elevated language, not everyday conversation. Well, I'm curious to see what some of our students are saying about this question about what would be an element of traditional tragedy. And I think Christopher, I think you started us off last week too. This is great. You must be very fast on your feet. But again, he's first in here with a comment. One characteristic of traditional tragedy is the use of verse. Bravo, good cueing there. These tragedies have profound topics and require profound language to convey ideas. For example, Shakespeare always used verse. I like the way, Christopher, you must have a little playwriting background yourself, because you actually did a little bit of poetry when you said, these tragedies have profound topics and require profound language to convey ideas. That repetition of the profound makes a point, and that's something that a poet would do, use repetition. When you maybe come and see Top Dog Underdog, although I warn you that a lot of the language is very adult language, still, Susan Laurie Parks uses repetition quite often in her language to give it a musical sense and a kind of sense that there's something fateful about these two brothers fighting. In the same way that you created that sensation of repeating yourself there, but to make a point. So very nice, Christopher, thank you. And here's Michaela. Michaela Mason is saying, traditional tragedy was usually about royalty and nobility. These people were often involved in tragic circumstances that they could not escape. Good point, Michaela. A lot of the work that was done was a reflection of what it's like to be king. And that was fascinating for many people. Realize that a lot of these theaters, even though in the ancient Greek times, everyone did go to the theater, but not everyone had the time to be able to do it too, same way today, perhaps. So it was more of your upper classes who were watching traditional tragedies, thus reflecting their stories. But yes, you needed to have someone in an elevated position also who was going to speak that elevated language. So they were two very necessary points there that we have. Yes, the elements here of all the tragic circumstances that are involved, very, very important, especially the tragic verse. And when you get to beautiful phrases like when Shakespeare uses out, out, brief candle to refer to the shortness, the horrible shortness of life, we know that we're being asked as an audience member to imagine this situation for ourselves. So the way that it draws an audience in by using some of these tools is quite adept. One of the tools that is used in both tragedy and serious dramas, comedies, is subtext. Unique that our author points this out. But subtext is the emotions and tensions and thoughts that are not expressed directly in the words, but under the words, subtext. And it's revealed in the play by what the actors are doing non-verbally. That's how you get to show the subtext. By subtext, we really mean, Stanislavski was the great authority on this, on finding out that an actor needs to convey on stage what really they are asking of the other character, what the relationship is really about. Because sometimes the playwright has words for you to say that don't convey that. But you as the actor have to go under the text, into the subtext, to be able to show who you are as a character, as well as what you are demanding of that other person in front of you. So the only way to show relationship on stage is really by subtext. Sometimes the words will not do it for you. So it is how a drama is conveyed, by the use of subtext. And remember, that was a graphic there, so make sure, Christopher, Michaela, you write this one down, because you're going to find that on the test, yes? Melodrama. Here's another odd form that came off of tragedy. It's almost in between two different forms. But melodrama, the word actually means music drama and comes from 19th century France when there was a lot of music put behind scenes. Every film does that now. I don't know if you're aware of it. In fact, a lot of times the music is used to try to move you in a way without you becoming aware of it. So that's the best of movie music, is when it's done almost as a subjective hint to the viewer. Anyway, that's its origins, but it has come to mean to us a kind of distinct way of heightening the dramatic mood. It very much in the 19th century was an emphasis on action and spectacular effects. Such plays like Uncle Tom's Cabin became very famous for Eliza crossing the ice. There was an avalanche in there. So any kind of spectacle is a good indication of melodrama. But also, in melodrama, the characterization is often shallow and very stereotypical. You had the good guy and you had the bad guy. In fact, Westerns are really melodramas, the way that they are designed to be so specifically good versus evil. And usually a happy ending, even though there has been some trouble in the process. So the triumph of good over evil is very much at the heart of melodrama. So melodrama is a lot more exaggerated, sometimes laughable to us because it seems so over the top, as you would say, of actors who play something for too much general kind of emotion. And, well, our soap operas, for instance, are melodramatic, where there's not as much in-depth character development, but there's a lot of fighting and spectacle that goes along with it. Comedy, obviously, is on the other side of the spectrum here, and it is a play that's certainly light in tone, but it's concerning issues that are not terribly serious and usually always has a happy ending, and it's designed to provoke laughter in the audience. Obviously, to amuse is what comedy is all about. And comedy, I think, as you read in your textbook, requires a sense that everything has somehow changed. Somehow the regular laws that apply to everyday life are no longer applicable. So comedy tends to detach an audience and make you much more aware of something of an artificial world that we're watching. Famous comedy from ancient Greece was Lysistrata, where the women decide they are so upset with the men for having this stupid war that, in reality, the Peloponnesian War was 30 years long, the women decide to have a sex strike. In other words, you're not getting anything from me, though I am married to you, until you end that silly war. It's a wonderful play by Aristophanes, and it kind of shows an imagined situation. Obviously, that would never happen today. I doubt it. But the purpose is not necessarily just empty. In a play like Lysistrata, and Aristotle said that actually there is a catharsis in comedy too, that laughter helps to release a lot of the tension that we have. So it's not just laughter, but in a way it's a healing aspect to comedy. One scholar, Nicole, said that comedy keeps people humble, balanced, and human by deriding stupidity, hypocrisy, and pretension. So it's interesting that Molière himself, famous playwright, comic playwright from France in the 1660s, said that same idea, that a comedy helps us to kind of get over ourselves and see our own foolishness, our own hypocrisies. So there's more to comedy than just laughter. But it usually is done with a great deal, there's Mr. Molière, thank you. Usually done with a great deal of wit and repartee, malaprops, where a character says a word that's wrong for what they mean. It's actually from a play called The Rivals by Mr. Sheridan, who wrote School for Scandal, where he had a character named Mrs. Malaprop, and she would always use the wrong word. Instead of saying, I'd like to have a conversation with you, she'd say, I'd like to have a convention with you. She would, and that became known as a malapropism for many years. So it's a form of pun. It's a form of verbal humor, of which there are many in the world of comedy. And plot complications abound in comedies. So the idea of mistaken identity becomes very important. Plays like Comedy of Errors are dependent on them. So it's one of the strongest techniques in comedy is to have two twins, two boys who look exactly alike, and everyone gets so confused over it. Twelfth Night features a brother and a sister who are twins who cause that same confusion when Viola has to take on a boy's clothing to kind of protect herself. And she doesn't realize that her brother is actually still alive. So when he shows up, everyone is totally confused. So yes, mistaken identity and plot complications, very, very important to comedy. And we have such a variety of comedies. There is upper class comedy of manners, where we are kind of living in a cultured world and the dialogue is, again, witty. Characters are meant to be kind of mocked. We are making fun of the hypocrisy of these characters. And that is truly Molière's greatest form of theater. He moved comedy to a whole new vein where he felt that a lot of what we should do in comedy is heal society by letting us look at hypocrisy. So many of his plays, we'll get a look at a few, were designed specifically to help people laugh at themselves, putting a mirror up, if you will, to the audience. But perhaps the form of comedy we most enjoy is farce, which is a more lower sense of humor, very physical kind of humor. In Commedia dell'arte, we had a character who would hit people with what was called a slapstick. And that word has come down to us to mean any kind of physical humor. So when you see Larry and Moe and Curly hitting each other and getting laughs that way, we call that slapstick. Truly is. But any kind of overly physical, exaggerated bits, as we call them in theater, to get a laugh is farce. So farce tends to be a little more violent, very rapid in movement, boys chasing girls. We actually have a form called bedroom farce, where it's always about the boy chasing the girl chasing the boy, whichever. So comedy of manners is a little more elevated. Farce is a little more down to earth. In our textbook, for instance, we have on page 211 a wonderful image of Noises Off, which is a show that we just did here last semester. Very difficult show to do, but it's all farce. You can look on your, in your book and see there's like eight doors in the play, and there's characters just running through the doors. It's like watching traffic. It's so busy. So that is very, very central to farce. Louder, faster, funnier is what a director usually says when they're directing farce. Louder, meaning the actors have to speak louder, and they have to move faster and be funnier. So, very famous statement for directors to make. Let's see, I think I left out a form here. We wanted to talk just briefly about modern tragedy and whether or not we have to have kings and princes on stage to have a real tragedy. And this has been a rather unique development in our culture ever since the 50s, when people like Arthur Miller and Lorraine Hansberry were saying, why can't we just have a play about a common man who's trying to help his family survive? Why can't that also be tragedy? And if you look at Raisin, as we will do, or Death of a Salesman, you find something that most all people can relate to, and that has redefined tragedy into a form that is perhaps more engaging for audiences because we can recognize the situations that these characters are going through. Not too many of us have been kings and queens and princes, so it makes sense that modern tragedy should perhaps pack a little more punch for audiences. And some of these modern tragedies have been quite poetic, like the plays of Lorca, the plays of August Wilson, which are beautifully written with language that is meant to be dialogue, but it has a kind of smoothness to it. Very much Susan Norrie Parks as well in Top Dog, Underdog. All right, well, I think we'll take a little break here. We've talked about melodrama, and we've talked about the two different forms of comedy. But let's come back from our break and take a look at this rather unique martial arts film, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. And I think you'll agree with me that Ang Lee has perhaps elevated this genre of film to a much more sophisticated handling. It's quite a beautiful piece of work. So hope you join us after the break for Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
You are watching THTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University, Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world. And to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
My name is Danaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
This is student life.
I'm home right now, but...
Go! Sweet!
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome back. It's Bill Deluca at Theater 100. And we're going to look at a wonderful martial arts film, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon by Ang Lee, featuring Michelle Yeoh and Chow Yun-fat. Wonderful piece of work. While we're on the topic of martial arts films, be curious to ask you, what is a genre film that you have liked? In fact, it's interesting to see, we were talking about the history of film, and there's so many different genres. Certain people have certain favorites that they always like. The oldest genre is the Western, believe it or not. By 1910, 21% of the films that were made were Westerns. This is the silent film era. So I don't know, is that one of your favorite films? Obviously we have such great Westerns like Stagecoach and High Noon and Fort Apache, some fabulous Westerns in our past. The gangster movie came in with the 20s and 30s, and that has stayed with us for a long time. We already mentioned Little Caesar and Public Enemy, but you may be more familiar with Scarface or Godfather, many great gangster films. In fact, film noir is actually a look at the American crime film, and these famous Raymond Chandler movies were very interesting in the 40s. The Big Sleep, Polanski's Chinatown was something of a film noir. Oh, there's Marlon Brando in The Godfather. So there's the classic of all gangster movies, yes? War films became hugely popular, obviously, with World War II, All Quiet on the Western Front, Bridge on the River Kwai, more recently, Deer Hunter, Platoon, Saving Private Ryan, Black Hawk Down. We thought that military films would leave us, but we still have a fascination with them. And of course, we love horror films. I'm sure that's a popular one. You may choose that. From Nosferatu and Frankenstein and The Fly, all the way to the famous ones in the 50s, Psycho, which we're going to see. That's one of our five films here. Nightmare on Elm Street, Scream, Blair Witch Project. I mean, these are shows that are just fascinating to people. There's that great look at Psycho, which we'll be seeing a couple weeks in. Science fiction. We love science fiction. The Invisible Man, The Thing. It's interesting how science fiction plays with our nervous anxieties. Even Star Wars and E.T., Minority Report. I mean, these are some great, great movies. The Matrix, that maybe is one of the most popular genres of all. There's Star Wars. Also, you know, in the 1920s, we created screwball comedies, and that has lived on from the My Man Godfrey all the way to My Big Fat Greek Wedding. So maybe that's your favorite genre. And of course, film musicals. Once we had the talkies, we had these great movies with Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, Gene Kelly, Judy Garland. So a lot of film musicals have been very popular genres. So today we're going to look at a martial arts film, which is another genre, but of course, I think Ang Lee has taken another step up, I think you'll agree, because he's brought a poetic sensibility to the martial arts film that is quite unique. In fact, this little clip that I'm going to show you right now kind of says it all. It's kind of a silent moment when you see the central character basically just practicing with his sword, though it is almost a beautiful poetic dance that he's doing in the moonlight. And Chow Yun-fat does a beautiful sense of movement. Of course, he's got wonderful lighting to create a kind of moonlight effect throughout the whole piece. And then you'll see Michelle Yao come in and watch him with a kind of intrigued expression on her face. But it shows you the kind of stylistic handling that you're going to see in this movie from all of the participants, not just Ang Lee. So this is Lee Mubai alone in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Lee is here. Lee Mubai is here.
Oops, sorry. I think that was the clip we were going to go to next, but that's okay. It comes later in the film, the clip I was going to show you. But let me just kick off the film for you first. It begins with this famous Wudang warrior whose name is Liu Mubai, and this is played by Chow Yun-fat. And he returns and he meets Yu Shulian, and this is played by Michelle Yeoh, quite beautifully played by Michelle Yeoh. They have a great love for each other, but her fiancé died, and according to traditional Chinese customs, that meant that you had to kind of grieve for him. So there's a tension between the two of them because they very much love each other, but they're not allowed to get together. So that establishes very early on when Li Mubai is reunited with Yu Shulian at the very beginning. He confesses to her that he's kind of lost his desire to fight because he's this famous warrior of mythic proportions. And he wants her to bring the Green Destiny Sword that he has used all these years to Sir Tay, who is someone that they both trust. She's shocked that he would be giving this up. And she asks if he would not like to accompany her to go and see Serté and give the sword to him. He does say that he's first going to visit his master's grave. His master was killed by this woman named Jade Fox, and he regrets that he's never been able to avenge that, but he's still confirmed on giving up the sword. So she goes to Serté, gives him the sword, and Serté kind of says, you know, how come you guys aren't getting together? You know you love each other. And she says, well, you know, we're busy and all that. And Serté says something about how when it comes to emotions, even great heroes can be idiots. So he feels, as the film does, you'll see, a sense that these two should really get together. But in comes the conflict. Enter Jen. And Jen is the daughter of Governor Yu, and she kind of creates problems. She's young. She's supposed to be married. She's been assigned this person to marry. And she's more captivated with the life of a warrior. In fact, she really asks Julien to tell her all about their relationship. So it's very much about a kind of a teenager growing up and making herself into a bit of a problem, I guess you could say. They put the sword away, and during the night, we meet Jen's governess too, and it turns out later on that her governess is actually the hated Jade Fox. So we get a little sense that there's some control that this governess has over poor Jen. So that night, and this is the point of attack of the film, this is where it all really begins, someone steals the Green Destiny Sword. And I think we have that clip coming up. And this is a moment that is very unique. We have a scene that actually goes on for like 8 minutes. They basically kind of are running over rooftops, and it's quite beautifully done technically, because we have not only great motion in terms of the camera, what the camera's doing, but the performers who are being held up by technicians on strings, it really looks like they're just flying. And it's done with quite a wonderful sense of style. I think we have that clip or one of the clips ready to go. Either clip I think will be fine. But this is a little scene from Crouching Tiger and Hidden Dragon. Thank you. really so wonderful. Now, I'm playing into perhaps the martial arts idea here. What you just saw was a martial arts display, but what's unique about the film is how well Ang Lee incorporates it into the plot. The whole previous section, the whole exposition of the film, is setting up this idea that Li Mu Bai is going to give away this famous sword and no longer fight. That has been really established. So the sword's importance is actually highlighted. Now someone steals the sword. So when we see Michelle Yeoh run after her, it's done for dramatic reasons, not just spectacle. You're watching them fight, but you're involved in what the dramatic action is. And that's what makes this film work, is that it's not just one excuse to have another display of martial arts or not. It's so tied into the story. And their characters are drawn in depth. They are obviously legendary warriors, both the Michelle Yeoh character as well as Li Mu Bai. So it's understandable. In fact, this thief that she has just been fighting is Jen. You can kind of tell with that small little mask that she has on. And it's obviously that she's fascinated with the intrigue of this world of fighting criminals. So she wants to become a criminal herself, and she steals the sword. it sets us up for something wrong that's going to mess up what has also been in the exposition of Li Mu Bai and Xu Lien kind of finally getting together, of him giving up the fighting and the sword, and now maybe they have a relationship. But it's going to be messed up, not just by Jen, but as we're going to see in this following scene, by Jade Fox, who has been going as her governess to kind of give her a sense that she's protecting her, but she really hasn't been. Interesting sequence, though. I mean, did you notice the wonderful handling of, for instance, slow motion? There was a section where you just saw their feet, and Ang Lee slowed it down so that you could see the one motion of the one fighter putting their foot on top of the other fighter's foot. So changing the pace became very much central to what happens in a film. What a great artist does in film is draw emphasis to what is really important. And that is perhaps one of the unique parts of film, is that it's not just telling the story. It's underlining, perhaps, for us what is really valuable in this scene. All right, we're going to see another one here. And so once the sword has been stolen, all kinds of problems are caused. One thing is that this thief has been spotted going into Governor Yu's compound. So now Michelle Yeoh, as Xu Lien, has to find a way to kind of delicately find out who this thief is without creating too much of a problem for Sirte. So she goes and talks to Jen, and Jen actually is fascinated with her stories about their love between Li Mu Bai and Xu Lien. And Jen asks if they can be sisters. So there's a kind of, even though they were just fighting, they didn't know who they were, but now Jen and Xu Lien become kind of sisterly in the film. Meanwhile, because of the news about the sword being stolen, a policeman suspects that it's Jade Fox. So a policeman comes and starts putting up posters of Jade Fox. And as it turns out, Xu Lien lets Li Mu Bai know this, and Li Mu Bai realizes that Jade Fox is here and he has to avenge his master's death. So he's going to need the sword back, is basically what happens here. So finally we get a scene where now this evil Jade Fox is fighting this policeman and his daughter, as well as another man. And Li Mu Bai, just as they're about to get killed, Li Mu Bai shows up and saves the day. And Li Mu Bai fights Jade Fox. And just as she's about to get killed by Li Mu Bai, who shows up but the thief again with the Green Destiny Sword. So she saves Jade Fox. And obviously it turns out that this is Jen saving the woman who has been her protector, but who has also showed her a lot of the information from the stolen manual that has helped her train into being a Wudan warrior, even though she has never worked with Limu Bai. Notice some of the camera work here too. So for instance, when you see the characters moving, notice that the camera is moving along with them so that you get a sense that you are watching the scene from the perspective, that point of view shot that I was talking about before. And it's done beautifully in this fight sequence. So this is another fight sequence from Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
This never killing you was a great mistake. You've had 10 years too many, Jade Fox. Oh, you do not remember me, but you knew my master. The greatest of all our teachers, Li Dan Pen. The year I was away, some woman arrived, disguised as a nun, poisoned Li Dan, and stole our secret training manual. Yes, I think it is time you answered for what you did to us all.
No, master, I had no respect for women. I was good enough to sleep with, but not to teach. What better punishment? Than to die by a woman's hand!
Wudan's highest martial arts. But after 10 years of training, your moves are still undisciplined. To die under a Wudan sword tonight is fitting and no disgrace!
Wudan dog, my disciple is here. Together we can kill them all.
No, let's go.
How many jade foxes are there?
Wait, just let me get rid of that meddler.
Yeah! Put! Yeah!
Who are you? And what are you doing with the Green Destiny Sword?
That's my affair.
My name is Li Mu Bai. The Green Destiny is mine. Bia Hudi is not good enough to teach that. That is a Xuan Ping move. How do you know it?
Just improvising.
Who is your real master?
So obviously this film features three very adept women in terms of their fighting skills, that's for sure. Did you notice though, there was some great moments, for instance, when Jen intercepts and all of a sudden you see the Green Destiny, there was this long shot that went through Limu Bai's sword right to the Green Destiny. It's almost like we were fighting and all of a sudden the film slowed down to focus on that contrast of the two swords. That's what a great film does. It changes your pace, it draws your attention in at moments, and it never lets one pace dominate too much. And that is the art of very good directorial pacing. And it's done throughout this film quite well. So anyway, this scene shows us that the governess was basic. Jen's governess was actually Jade Fox. So this is the real point of attack of the film, the real conflict now, because now we've got Li Mu Bai who has to find Jade Fox. They get away in this scene after killing the policeman. And in fact, Xu Lien becomes involved in this, and she talks to Jen and kind of convinces her, not directly, but hints that it may be a good idea for her to give the sword back. And this next scene we're actually going to see, Jen disguises herself again and brings the sword back, but Li Mu Bai catches her. And he catches her and chases after her, not so much to incarcerate her, as much as he feels that she is ready to become a Wudan warrior. In other words, he wants to train her himself. So he thinks she has great potential. And this is part of where the film is very extraordinary. It's about whether Jen is going to be on the evil side like Jade Fox and just want to be a thief, or is she going to join the more noble values of like Li Mubai and Shulian, who want her to use her skills to do good. So it's almost like the whole film is the battle for the soul of Jen. And you'll see in this, Li Mubai almost convinces her, but she last minute breaks away. So anyway, this is Jen versus Li in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Isn't it a little late to be out? Just give it to me.
I'll return the sword how and when I please.
Your master, where is she?
None of your business!
I can tell you have studied the technique, but you have misunderstood quite a bit. You need real training with someone who can teach you right.
You'd like to be my master, but who knows if you have the skill?
You are right. Li Mubai means skill. Wudan signifies skill. Even this sword here stands for skill, but it is all really a state of mind.
Don't talk like a monk just because you're in a temple. Just fight!
I am not after you. Biahuri is the one I...
Leave her out of this!
Real skill comes without effort. Lesson for you, just for a start.
Go ahead.
Why should I? It is practice you need. There are endless things you could learn to do with the Green Destiny. But to start with, you must learn to hold it in stillness.
What do you want to teach me?
Wudan is not an art for everyone. I have always imagined myself as the teacher of a student truly worthy of it.
Aren't you afraid I'd kill you once I mastered it?
Deep down, you are good, so I will take my chances. When I see that Biahuri's corruption has not tainted you, I feel secure.
Wudan is a whorehouse. You can keep your lessons to yourself!
So he doesn't succeed on his first attempt to kind of talk her into joining him. So it's interesting how the film plays at the idea of what Jen is going to do. Is she going to turn to the evil side or to the good side? I see we have a couple comments here on my focus question about genres. And here's Alex. I really like romantic comedies because I like to relate to the stories going on in the film as well as have a good laugh. Yes, I find romantic comedies are always going to be very popular. They've been popular ever since the 20s. So I agree with you, Alex. It's a great idea to keep those coming. Here's Christella saying, what genre is The Great Gatsby? Well, I didn't see the movie. I don't know if they turned it into an adventure film with Leonardo DiCaprio in it, but it is basically a classic piece of literature, so it's more of a literary classic as a genre than any kind of horror film or science fiction film or whatever. And Danielle, my favorite genre of film is drama or comedy. I feel that most are relatable and enjoyable. Very good, Danielle. In fact, I think you asked last week about the butler. I ended up seeing the butler this week, which was a very interesting look at the whole civil rights movement, but told in a more focused version through the experience of this one man who had served some six or seven presidents, all the way from Eisenhower to Reagan, and wonderfully portrayed, very, very well acted show. But Forrest Whitaker's, I could watch him do anything. Terrific. Thanks, Danielle. And here's Johnny Caratini. I think that one genre of film that I enjoy is the science fiction. This genre allows the viewer to experience situations that would otherwise be difficult or nearly impossible to experience in real life. Very good, Johnny. It gives us a chance to go beyond our own everyday reality, which is probably why we go to a film in the first place, to go further than what real life can give us. I think you have some more there, but yeah, I'll read it on the next round. Okay, the next clip I want to show is a little bit more of this kind of wonderful illusion of dancing in the air. They find out that Jade Fox has killed this policeman, and Jen actually has a battle with her and sends her away. So we get rid of Jade Fox, although she threatens to come back and teach her one more lesson now that seems like Limu Bai is taking more control. Notice in all the clips that we see in this film, the eyes are very important. This is a film that makes use of beautiful eyes, and we have many beautiful eyes among the actors in this. And then what happens is a very unique thing. Jen is visited by a man who turns out to be her lover, Lo. She met him in the desert, and he's this infamous robber known as Dark Cloud. And there's a moment where she could decide to just run off with him instead of getting married the next day to this person that the parents have decided. So she has a flashback. This is a huge flashback. And she flashes back to the time that she was traveling through the desert with her mother and a whole band of servants. And Lo and his villains attack them. And he steals her comb. And she runs after him to get the comb. And they end up falling in love. But anyway, this is just a little extended chase scene from Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
It's all right, madam. Do not be afraid.
Your mother might miss you. Run home to her.
Ch-ch-ch-ch.
And I got news for you that this scene continues. She ends up getting a horse and going after him again. They fight, they're rolling down hillsides, all to get her comb back. So it's a wonderful sense of humor that instructs this sequence, but you also get a sense of how Jen is so determined. She's really forceful. Once she has an idea in her head, she's gonna stick to it. And that's what causes the problem of the whole film. Her insistence on supporting Jade Fox, who turns out to now come back and offer some problems there for Limu Bai and for Shulien. Anyway, what happens here is when we come back to reality, Lo tries to get her to run away with him rather than go through this marriage, but she decides that she can't do that, and he tries to disrupt the marriage. And in fact, Limu Bai and Shulien talk him into going to Wudan Mountain, where they will bring Jen so that they can be together. So it seems like the two couples of the play try to help each other out here. In fact, I've showed you a lot of martial arts scenes. There's a lot of beautiful poetic romance sections. This next clip, for instance, shows you a beautifully arranged, it's almost like a painting, the way that Ang Lee has composed the image of Limu Bai sitting next to Shulien, and I think they're having tea. But you'll notice it was an attempt to kind of portray the kind of peace, the kind of life that they could have lived together if they weren't going to be separated by Jade Fox. So this is another beautiful scene of Limu Bai and Shulien from Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Shulien, the things we can touch have no permanence. It is all an illusion. The master would say, a man's primary need is to let go. Only then can he possess what is truly real.
Yes, I am sure many things are an illusion. Yet some are hopelessly real. Like my hand, wasn't that real?
Rough and calloused. The hand of a Xuan Tao master, how I've longed to touch it and never dared. Shulien, we are beset with peril, and it is not weapons. The real danger resides in the human heart. I tried to leave the Jianghu world for you, and look what trouble that has brought us.
The feelings one represses just strengthen.
You are right, but what do I do then? What I would like is us, together as we are here, it gives me a sense of infinite peace.
Interesting that last shot, I don't know if you caught it there, but so simple, so powerful, but it says so much. They're sitting there together in what would normally be a romantic gaze at each other, but they're looking both off into the distance. It's almost as if Ang Lee wanted to portray their life as being one where they were not looking at each other. It was not a self-consumption in their life. It was a life of dedication to other goals. And it's quite a noble gesture that he portrayed in that way. I think what I'm going to do here, since we're kind of running out of time, I want to jump to clip number 8, if you don't mind, instead of the Master Long scene. What happens here is the sword disappears again. Evidently, what Jen decides to do is to steal the Green Destiny and run away from having to marry this guy. And now we actually get a scene where she fights all of these men in this tea house. But I'd like to jump to the next scene, which is where we see Jen has now antagonized Shulien so much that they really come to blows. And this is where they have quite a beautiful battle. And what will happen is Limu Bai will run after her, and you'll see there's this beautiful section where they're in bamboo trees that makes fighting seem almost a graceful dance. So this is Jen and Shu and Limu Bai from Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Give me that sword. Take it!
That's enough! You are not worthy of that sword.
Are you lecturing again? Stand!
Well, you're just going to have to go and see the film yourself so that you can see this wonderful section. See where Jen flies off. Wouldn't it be wonderful if you could fly? And there she is flying across the pond, and Limu Bai kind of goes after her. And they have this wonderful sequence where they're fighting in these in this bamboo forest, but it's so poetic. It's quite graceful. And that is the heart of this film, that the battle scenes are actually quite lovely. You enjoy them because they become danced rather than fought. Anyway, I'm not going to tell you how it ends. I think you got to go and see this film yourself. I'm sure perhaps you haven't heard of it before, and so maybe get it on Netflix and enjoy it. It is, yes, a martial arts film, but it is wonderfully poetic. You may have heard the wonderful sound of Yo-Yo Ma's cello in the background for many of the scenes. So I hope you'll enjoy it. Next week, we'll go off and look at directing in Theater 100. So thanks for joining us today.